my way into February, the weather not as good, most particularly in the mild zone where I'm engaging. Did some strategic movement, pushed an Italian army into place here. Now, I've heard some people are a little iffy about the, hey, maybe all the units shouldn't have the same strength. Realize this. The units that are on the board right now are all kind of generic units. A little later, we start seeing some elite units come into play, like when the SS divisions get formed, the Russian units. There's no strength factor. They get modifiers on the combat chart. So, you know, the result is essentially the same as having different strengths, as long as you recognize, you know, that they have the same general capacity. One army is about the same as another in general, but you do manage to get, let's see, the elite unit is a plus one bonus. You also, of course, have the differentiation of the armored capabilities, which are going to be another plus one or plus two. And then you have national differentiation. German units are not the equivalent of, or Italian units are not the equivalent of German units. So this guy, I will not want to use him as a primary attacker for the most part. The Germans get a plus two to attack. The Italians and the Russians and the Poles do not. I think the UK and English get a plus one, as do the UK and the English. The US, UK, and French all get plus one. Of course, that's made up for by the improved Soviet units. There's a lot of elite Soviet units, which bring them up into the same sphere as the regulars for the Western Allies. The Italians, though, are the equivalent of most miners and of the Russians. They make good support troops, not terribly good, so you can actually, I could activate this, move it into place here, do an assault, activate this, do an assault, and I get the same plus one that I would get off any German unit. As long as I make this guy my primary attacker, I still get the plus two for the attack. So, there's not a uniformity across, but there is a uniformity across a single nation. And I don't much mind that. You know, there's a level of abstraction here that I can accept that kind of treatment on this kind of scale of game. Let's see. We had some more going on. Something I meant to mention before, and I don't think I did. The French have a lot more national will now. That's because they regain. So as soon as the Nazi-Soviet pact goes away, the French regain 15 points of national will. If, on the other hand, the Germans had attacked westward and broken the appeasement policy, I think the Russians get something like 40. So this attack east first, you're attacking a much, much weaker Soviet Union, one that's much, much more willing to collapse. And there's this whole Moscow Treaty rule that comes into play, which allows the Germans to then buy some time off that. All right, I'm going to start my operation, see if I can crack Warsaw, but I doubt that I can with this kind of weather going on. First of all, there's one interesting thing. I forgot I did another strategic move down here with the Romanians. Looks to me like the paratroopers can actually still be used in this severe weather. That seems weird to me. Maybe I'm missing something, but when I look here, I don't see any indication of that. Maybe I didn't think to look in here, but I think it just refers you to that rule. Most of the chits have the rule almost completely explained in here. Yeah, just see placement. I don't see any restriction against using them in the deep winter now. So that may be in play. I can't use the air units. They have no effect. These guys here did an assault and forced the Russians back a space. Now they're used up and they got no bonus for being armor or anything, but now I get to do the clever thing. I paid a point for this thing, and 1, 2, 3, I move into here and I declare an assault. I'm going to be able to get 3 units on Warsaw itself, and remember, Warsaw is enough to crack the Poles and force them out of the war.
Oh, using the paratroopers, and I gotta roll to see if I lose them. Nope. Coming in two turns later, I actually succeeded in that assault. Here's where I made a mistake. If I had backed this up with more forces here, I would have had to, and this is kind of weird, I would have had to stand there and would have taken a step loss instead. But now Poland is destroyed because I must retreat. If this was a fortress, I would have had the option not to. But instead I have to retreat. And I don't know which one I was going to take as my lead unit, but this one makes the most sense. Take some of these off the board. And that's going to be a quick 4 points off the national will for Poland, and I believe they immediately collapsed due to that. Had I had a unit back there, I wouldn't have had to retreat. I would have taken a step loss instead, and Poland would still be alive, given how much I've kind of screwed up with the weather for the Germans. I'm going to let them slip in here on Poland, not try to correct that. And that's going to dig some nasty holes and open up some Soviet units to potential uglier attacks, possible isolation, etc. There's no ability to just say, the line's collapsing. I want to trump in and try to retreat or something like that. You're stuck with the effects of that line collapse. Whether or not that's good, I'm not sure. I kind of like the idea of being able to trump in on that kind of circumstance. I almost feel like this game... the combat system for this game doesn't allow enough reactive capabilities. On the other hand, attacking's hard enough. So we'll see, because we've seen that attacking is not trivial here. Now a series of events happen and take place. The first thing that happens is a pro-axis marker gets thrown into the cup. So now I've got a diplomatic success, which only works for me. If somebody else draws it, it ends up not going in here, but back in the discard pile. So if the Allies grab that, there might be a reason the Allies don't want to put new things in there, just to try to cancel that event out before I can get it, because it can only help me. The Polish army is coming off the map. Let's see. I'm going to be able to select a neutral country. If it had a pro-Soviet country on the board, I could reverse that course, but I can't do that to Romania. They're already in the war, but let's say they had succeeded with Turkey. I could reverse that. Alternatively, I can take a neutral that is adjacent to Poland and swing that into the war, and basically swing that into my camp. Basically, that looks like it is either Hungary or Lithuania. Those are my only options, and I got to kind of look at them. I think Hungary has the better forces. On the other hand, there's some advantages to having Lithuania tumble in just because of its closeness. It's at risk of being captured, though, so I think it's more likely I'm going to throw Hungary into the war here. I get the allied countries. I get a bonus unit, which I've moved a garrison into play. Okay, I'm down in the Soviets there. My national will goes up. I think it was 3 points because of the three factories that Poland had. In particular, in Poland, the Polish quarter disputed region is ceded to Germany. Now, I realized something weird when I saw this. My Italians were up here. They couldn't be because that's German territory. If they were in the Polish quarter after it gets ceded, they'd get repatriated home. So since there was some chance of that, I moved them over here since I cheated with them in the first place. But now the other side of this is everybody has to leave there. Then the Eastern Poland disputed area is ceded to the USSR. Now, even though the USSR obviously isn't acceding to the Nazi-Soviet pact, it does make some sense that they'd simply assume control over Eastern Poland, especially since the Germans aren't there. So they've now gained control of that. Now, when they gain control, they also get, I think it's three national will of their own for this.
And both Germany for Posen and the Soviets for Bray end up with an extra factory, which I've recorded. This is one of the few ways you can get production is through ceded areas. And the USSR also gets a conditional unit. And in this case, I didn't have a whole hell of a lot of options. Basically, I could take an infantry unit or an air unit. I chose to take the infantry unit. I need more troops, although my parity in air power, I'm behind on that. I feel like I need ground troops more because there's these big gaps and I'm going to have holes blown through my line that's too far forward. And in a really risky position up there. All right, now I continue. Well, first I have to make my decision on Hungary and Lithuania, but then I'm going to continue with the German activations. They get to continue, you know, trying to knock out some of these Soviet armies that are out here. Now remember, there's no special isolated rules in this in terms of a permanently eliminated unit. You eliminate a unit, it just goes into the eliminated box and it will be available for rebuilding. No idea of like, oh yeah, you captured the cadre, they'll never be able to rebuild those forces. I understand cadre ideas and rules, however, they usually seem somewhat ridiculous in full-on strategic games. I know some that have them. In particular, I'm thinking World War One games. Both La Grande Guerre has it, the Rand game has it, the Great War, SPI's World War One has it. I think Paths of Glory has it. I haven't played that enough to really remember. It's, to me, very odd to see the counter mix reduced by that, because the full manpower is still there. It should just take you longer to rebuild those units that have been destroyed out of supply. And in a sense here, anything that's destroyed is going to take you a little longer to produce. I could see maybe saying, yeah, there's some effect of pocketing and capturing the forces. But, you know, again, the level of the abstraction, I think it's fair not to have that. All right, well, let's see what the Germans can do to the Soviets. Oops. And now sorry about that swing. I thought I had hit the button for off. The Germans had to move through Krakow to take control of it and shifted a unit up here. I was kind of iffy because when I count my production at this point, I've got three planes that I've got to upgrade. That's 9 points. 10, there's a damaged infantry here. 11. 12, I could rebuild this infantry. Well, I only have 16 left. That means I'm only going to have 4, which is not a chance for diplomacy. So I'm already, at this point, below the production I need. Now, my production is going to go up by a couple of points each turn because of Posen here, which I don't have a control marker on because I've got the Polish corridor seated space on there. Likewise, I'm not sure if there would be a control marker for here for the Soviets. I don't know. I don't know how much this even really matters, except that I assume that's still Allied control until I moved into it. So I took a penalty. I didn't see anything that changes control when you conquer a country. But now, well, the Western Allies don't have anything they can do. Their limitations keep them from moving the BEF into France. So pretty much the only thing I've got left. Oh, I may have a Mediterranean crisis. Crap, bringing those Italians in. I gotta look that sucker up. I think I may have done that. Whoops. As a matter of fact, it does cause the that exact issue. And what that means is not a lot. It happens if the Axis moves into, or is placed in a country sharing a border with France or UK, overseas area. Well, we have that with this, the placement in Tripoli. So bringing Italy into the war guarantees that. Or this does not occur if the Axis unit or marker is only in France or UK mainland area. Sharing a border with a France or UK overseas, I think. Anyway, also it would happen if the USA joins. When it happens, the Western faction gets the following after the setup. All the French ground units come into play on overseas areas, as do all the UK ground units, but they can't go in Egypt. And then I'm allowed to place convoys into the proper locations. Well, the French only have one convoy, and I'm going to use that to supply, North Africa. But there's some problems with this. These guys aren't in full supply. They're in low supply, if I don't trace. So this is going to immediately get a low supply marker. It can trace to the capital of the area, but it's not considered fully supplied with, and there's some penalties for that. Tell you the truth, these Italians are probably in low supply too. I just haven't been really worrying about it because they don't really affect much. But I do have to consider that that is a possibility. Things don't die due to low supply, but they're less combat effective. So I don't know how big a deal it is. I may have to play out the Allied turn in order to take advantage of the thing, to make sure that I can do this notionally from now on. I'm going to have to play through it once. So here's one example. We're going to be shipping these units out of Northern Ireland, I guess, back to Britain. Not sure what the status. I think maybe forts always provide you supply if you're in them. I have to check that as well. And then, of course, the Soviets are going to have to fall back. And you can see they've got a unit cut off here by the Germans. I'm going to rotate a bunch of pieces. So that's another factor at play here. I again chose not to use my air support to attack the Soviet units, the Soviet air units, simply because I think I've got better odds in poor weather than I do in severe weather. I think the severe weather is more likely to just be one-to-one trade-offs. And I definitely have better odds as I repair the units. The German plus two advantage counteracts the minus two from the sorties, whereas the Russians just have a minus on their sorties. So the way the tables work, you want to let, if you want the offensive, if you've got the better advantage in the air combat, as the Germans do, you want to repair your planes more, because otherwise you'll be trading it even, whereas you can probably get 2-1 if you're attacking while both are well supplied. Righto. All right. I'm not too worried. I shifted these forces to ports because garrisons are okay if they're in ports or on islands. So Malta, Gibraltar is going to be a port. I'm okay with all of the garrisons that are on the board. I do have to keep supplying this. I guess I haven't really been paying attention to it at all. But I've certainly had enough production to run my convoy from here. Or there was one in Alexandria, but that's now shifted. The Belfast unit I've thrown down here into Port Said. You could make some questions as to, hey, shouldn't I have pushed that into Great Britain or something? I don't know. I really don't know. But by shipping it here, that's going to work fine. I've got tons of production on the Allies that they're not able to use, so I'm not too worried about this. From the German or Axis side, these are both Italian garrisons down here, so they're not really a problem either, as is the one I threw in Albania for some reason. So I'd say that's the Western Allied turn. Now it's time for me to figure out how to cope with my Soviets, and I probably want to build myself a supply line here, see if there's anything else I can do of value. Yeah, this is part of the Soviet Union now, so I can't just march into there either. My Romanians are kind of stymied and useless. Oops. As we round out the turn and pushing things into the eliminated box, I'll finish. Look at those new units as we come. I got to deal with the randoms, among other things. significant diplomatic action. First of all, the Germans picked the pro-Axis marker that they just threw in. And give them a good shake. I don't know. Feels like the same counter that I just put in last is always coming up. But there are a decent number of these. One of the things Sal pointed out to me, I think I may have said there was an equal amount or 3-2. It's actually 3 successes to 1 failure, I think, is what the actual balance is. Anyway, the Hungarians have come into the war. That's opening up a front against Romania that's going to be of some interest. If I can conquer Romania, that allows me, you know, then to push things into either Yugoslavia or Bulgaria, so that's kind of pleasing too. The conquest of Yugoslavia, if you were playing the standard game, would help you towards getting Hungary or Romania. The attack on Greece helps you towards Bulgaria or Turkey. But diplomatic successes both for the Western allies, which they threw in Spain. Really shouldn't have done that Zoom. I gotta look while I'm working, right? Yeah. Used to know that. And then Russia threw one into Turkey again. So this is providing the Germans with kind of a dangerous position here, because even if they get a success, they're going to have the choice between knocking 1 or 2 out. Whereas with the Allies, and the Axis can't throw these in without allowing the other two to get a bonus off of me throwing them in. So I don't want to do that. So now there are as many successes as failures in there. I've got no bonus, no extra chip. So probably next turn the Axis isn't going to do a diplomacy action. There's just no value to it. Unless I'm allowed to throw a no event in on its own, which may be the case. And putting that in for 5 might be worthwhile. However, it doesn't really do me anything. If the Allies throw this in, it's the same value. Anyway, I've got 2 nasties to deal with. In terms of options, I really do not want to particularly see either Turkey or Spain come in on one of the other sides. As we enter springtime, we get more not-so-good weather. Now, that's kind of to be expected. If you look March, April, we're not going to see much there. We also have the winter line. We're right up against here. We're ready to cross over that. That's the severe weather here. Now, severe might be better than poor, depending on you know, what assets you have available, etc. Tanks and airplanes work better in poor, but if you have the overall advantages, and the +2 troop strength might be part of that overall advantage, is attacking is easier in the severe weather. Germany opened up with a declaration of war on Lithuania. They become a pro-Soviet country. I'm realizing I screwed up here. When I brought Hungary in, I think I could have instead been bringing Yugoslavia in. No, because it had to be adjacent to Poland. That's why it had to be Hungary. Okay. Yeah. It would be Yugoslavia would be one of the more appealing choices. One of the reasons for attacking Lithuania is I'll get, once I succeed in taking it, a pro-Axis marker in the cup and a pro-Axis marker, say, in Latvia, which isn't going to be terribly helpful. Not really looking too much in favor of capturing the Baltic states. The economics, there's still no strategic warfare because I haven't crossed into Russia yet. Yeah, this is the winter line here. It's closer than it is than I thought it would be. And that's going to put us, I guess, into strategic movement. And, well, take these suckers off the map. Probably move some Italians. I can't move the Italians into Hungary, which I'd kind of like to have more support coming in there. So I guess I'll throw more into Poland, it looks like. Not quite sure where. Yeah, I can just slip them into there. I've run into a bit of an ambiguity here. I'm looking, and I'm not sure how I'll resolve it, but during a mobile attack, basically, as you're going through, hey, you can do either a mobile attack, or if you didn't do a mobile attack, you can do an assault attack. And this important section, it says to initiate a mobile attack or doesn't... Ah, yes. Okay.
No ambiguity. Me just not reading well. Yeah, I was looking at the charts here, and maybe I've misplayed this, but whenever you make any kind of attack, you have to pay the additional cost. I may have fudged that with some assaults so far. Anyway, the Germans have been pushing their way through. They've knocked out one Soviet unit. They've invaded Lithuania. Now, that's going to mean the East Invaded event takes place. That doesn't take place, though, until after my operations phase with the Germans. That's going to give the Russians some immediate reinforcements, all kind of cool shit. But, you know, I mean, my goal is to invade Russia. The question, of course, is, would I have been better off kind of holding off in the limited war? Whether or not I could invade East Poland, or if that's part of the USSR now, is something I'm not certain about. I would have to look up. Rather than look that up, I figured I would take the Lithuanians out of the game. Now, they're not gone yet. I've made my attacks against them, but you can see I've isolated a Russian unit here. The other one I destroyed, I had isolated. And now I'm kind of looking at, well, if I move this guy, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, he can't make it, but, you know, could I set up an isolation and an assault with these guys? Well, no, not if I didn't have the movement points to launch the attack into there, no matter what. We do have some rough terrain, so that's going to be a little problem. That's something I've actually noticed here. The hexes are about the same size as the counters, and a lot of games have this, but some of the terrain features, it's hard to see them. You know, if a counter's in the hex, the terrain feature just disappears. I've noticed a lot of games don't seem to have that problem with the same size hexes, just the way the terrain features work. So, for example, these mountains, it wouldn't be an issue here. But with these little swamp doinkers here, I committed to an attack and then didn't find out until after I rolled and decided to damage a unit that, oh, there was some terrain there. How am I going to deal with that? Well, let's see if it makes a difference. Nah, it doesn't. But I might not have wanted to make the attack if I could see it. It's just really a graphical issue that there's a few places in this game where it kind of takes effect. You kind of wish the forests or whatever maybe bled out of their hex rather than trying to make sure that the hex sides are clean. If you're given that choice. Now, of course, where they do bleed, no, that's not a hex line, that's a rail line. Yeah, the map is, you know, it's very clear to being able to see, hey, which hexes have that or not when there's not a unit in it. But when there's a unit in it, it could be possible that it could cover up, because unless there's more terrain adjacent of the same type, there's some little blotches that you just can't see. The cities have the same issue, a little dot that's very easy to cover up. Had that happen a couple of times too. I'm sure familiarity with the map, eventually you get used to where the things are most of the time, but right now the East Invaded event takes place. Let's take a look at what that means. First of all, if the Russians had done any seizures, the countries, say Finland, that they did a seizure against, is Finland available for that? Yeah, they can Karelia for it, of course. The countries that they took a seizure from might declare war, become pro-Axis. One of them does. And that's kind of a nice little factor to push some alliance into play there. I don't get any such bonus, though. I don't think I get anything in the pit for this invasion. In the cup. There we go. East invaded. Okay. Right. Okay, now the Soviets get an air unit and 5 ground units as construction. Now, the air unit came in with 4 hits on it. The ground units, because they're Soviet ground units, come in at full strength in cities. So I've got a lot of new Soviet troops. You know, things look like, Jesus, everything's going to fall. No. You make that first turn invasion, and now there's some reserves. Mother Russia is not so weak. Lend-lease, policy evaluation. Some additional reserves are put on the game track. I think it's 6 turns later.
The Russian winter is set up for December. We'll talk about that in a bit. Soviet partisans are set up on the track. Strategic warfare begins, which means we get the factory loss markers here. And from now on every turn, we're going to be conducting a strategic warfare phase between the Soviets and the Germans. And the Urals factories go on the board. Okay, let's talk about some of these. First of all, there's a pile of reinforcements over here. There's also some partisans there, and a year later. Those work kind of like paratroopers. The only difference is instead of placing them within range of an air unit, they're placed within a country that's been conquered by the enemy. And they don't get lost on a six. You don't end up giving up on invasion, partisans. The Urals factories, the way they're going to go is they, one of them gets set up here on the extra factories chart. And I'm going to get an extra factory from that. And that adds to my total production then. The other one gets moved two hexes in front, or two turns in front. And then each time it gets hit, it'll move two spaces ahead, and another factory will be added to the extra factories. Lend-lease works very similarly, except that the increase is slower. I think it's every six turns. So I don't know where lend-lease is in a year, and we're going to see that. The policy evaluation, that's how long I got before the Western Allies can start cranking in. Guaranteed? No. They got a 50-50 chance of declaring war each turn, starting with that one. So I've got 1 year to finish this war with Russia before I can turn against them. And we'll see if that's possible for me. I seem to be doing okay on the attack once I, so far. And I've got good weather coming up, I hope. So we should be able to make some ground. The only problem is this comes after winter. If you aim it for later, you get more time before the Western Allies come in. That's not applicable in terms of determining the Barbarossa itself. But here, when I'm attacking just the Soviets, it does become a real pressure as to, hey, when did I want to launch this? Was March really the best turn to do it in? Trying to see. Okay, so I don't know yet about Russian winter. That's the one thing that I wanted to look up here. I looked up all the rest, and then I forgot about the Russian winter. Here it is. The markers put, it's removed from the scenario before the axis rolls for weather in the following. So it ends in March, and I think it just works for one winter. It'll go in the cold zone's poor box, and then the cold zone's weather marker. Okay, when this marker is removed from the turn box, put it on the cold zone's poor box, and put the cold zone's weather in the severe. While it's there, the weather is severe, but not for the Soviets. It's only poor. Now, you can remember, I'm not sure whether I like poor or severe better. I didn't really suffer too much from making attacks in severe. It's a mixed bag. So I'm not sure how harsh the Soviet winter is there. And that seems to be all for that. So that's where we are. Now we go to the Allied movement. I don't think there's anything going on. Again, I'm pretty much convinced that I can maintain everything in supply and pay it off. Maybe I'll worry about it as I start to get closer, as more things come onto the board. Anything else here? Yeah. Obviously, I didn't decide to do an Italian attack going through Turkey with the boats. That just doesn't seem like a valuable use of my surprise attack counter. The surprise attack counter can be used for multiple things. One, it can allow you invasions. The other is it can be used for ground attacks. Let's see if I can find it. Mm-hmm. There it is. If it's in a land hex, it's a plus one DRM to everything within two hexes of it. If it's in a C zone, it gives you a DRM in that in combats in that C zone. You can do a carrier strike. You can't do carrier strikes otherwise. It can allow an amphibious invasion or two if you're the allies. And although they're tied to a specific country in terms of who purchases the surprise attack counter, who has to purchase it, they're not tied to a specific country in terms of who can use it. So I could slap the surprise attack here and still launch an Italian invasion. Not sure what else I have to say here. Probably nothing. Oh, the Germans actually didn't move. I rebased one of my airplanes, but I didn't move this unit because, again, I'm down to my limit here, basically. I've got 17 points. Well, 12 of them are tied up in replacements. Well, rebuilding here, three here, and then nine for the air units. I didn't take any casualties this turn yet. I might. And then that leaves me five for diplomacy. I'd really like to knock out something like the Spanish counter or the pro-Soviet counter in one of those two if I can possibly do it. Not sure how likely that is, though, with the political success markers here. So maybe drawing isn't such a great idea, actually. Let's launch a quick counterattack here. This is kind of an attritional attack, an assault. But the Germans have nowhere they can retreat to because I stuck this damn German up here in the north. And that means that I ended up taking a step loss. Now, I'm in supply here, 1-2, and then rending the rail to there. So I can recuperate it. But remember, I was at the limit of my production. On the other hand, the Russians are also at the limit of their production. They got a new air unit in play and had to reduce their points overall for that. This air unit is kind of exposed out here with six sorties on it. I can't voluntarily move it. So I got to kind of hope the Axis overruns it. I'm probably not going to spend points on it. But my other points, I've got 1, 2 air units that need to be replaced, these two. So that's 8, 9, 10. I've only got 12 points left. So if I'm going to do a diplomacy, I'm not going to be able to repair everything even that I want to repair. So I'm just going to leave these poor suckers out here to let them get knocked back. I still have my garrison in place. You can see the Romanians have also moved into place. I filled in the line a little bit in a lot of places, so that the Soviets have something like a defensive line here. I wanted to save this guy, because again, if you lose units, well, it might have been a better idea not to save him, because if he's out of supply, I could remove him from the map without taking the national will loss. And now, he's not in that good position. I've got to remember to do that. That's a neat tool available. Rather than saving units, let them dissolve. But, well, I'm going to be making mistakes left and right, so I'm not too worried about, especially when I make a tactical mistake of some sort. If I make a big rules mistake, like with the weather factor, well, that could have a huge impact. But this unit could as well. Anyway, what that meant is some of these rear Soviet units didn't move up as far as maybe I'd like to. I just don't have the fuel to move all my armies. I can use strategic movement to shove them closer into place, though. And right now I've got a pretty nice line running all the way up from Lithuania down through Romania. That looks fairly solid. It's not to say that the Germans can't punch through it, but at least they have to make an effort. It's not like all of Russia's got a big opening gaping on it, which would have been a problem. That's going to move us, our supply, we're fine, to the economics, the replacements, etc. And I'll probably come back after the political. As we move into April, not much different. The political actions, Germany pulled a no event, the Allies threw a political success and a no event in, the Soviets pulled a no event. So, not a lot of movement there. Replacements, mobilization, a couple new German units. The Russians were kind of stretched and had to pay, basically. They could only afford their replacement points. I did upgrade this thing. If I'm going to be there, I might as well try to defend it a little bit better. I can always demobilize it next turn, I guess. I don't want to take the loss of a damaged unit in the front line. But you can see the mobilization pool's getting kind of big. There's a lot of units that I could build but don't have the points because I spent them on diplomacy instead. But all right, we're ready. We should be seeing the main of the Barbarossa starting pretty soon with the good weather, etc. And there's just so little in the way right now. Oh, and we're still seeing some pretty bad muddy weather down here in the warmer zones. Decent, poor weather in the cold zone, which is where I'm heading. I'm not sure, again, which one I like better or worse. Little bit of difference in the economic phase. Because the Russians ran up against a barrier in money, they're not giving any money to the Lithuanians. They are giving some to the Romanians, though. They think the Romanians are going to need it. They're kind of helping hold the important part of the line. They don't feel like the Lithuanians really need to both take an action and repair a unit. But we'll see. It's just, my feeling is that if the Germans concentrate on Lithuania, they knock it out, and then I lose the buck that I spent. And since I wasn't able to build all my units, I don't want to waste production on the Lithuanians there. Okay. So this is the first of the... Actually, I should check. Can I send money to anyone? I don't think so. I think only within my faction outside of the Lend-Lease. But that is something I had had a question about earlier. I don't think I resolved that for myself. Yeah, only within its own faction. Yep. Okay. So, I just wanted to check because there's a special rule about UK and US, but they just can't send money to each other. Lend-Lease already takes care of that. So, what do we... The US has no money, or has all the money. The next thing that happens is we hit the strategic warfare phase, and since we have the FAC loss markers on the map, we have to resolve a strategic combat between the Axis and Soviets. Well, we haven't done this yet, so I thought I'd take a quick shot at it, and most of it's on the chart. You don't really have to see the rules. Most of the game is on the charts. Once you know the rules, it kind of sticks, although there's some things that I feel like I have to look up every now and then, like what is your home, what, where you can build and stuff like that. Okay, so Axis air unit in a port in C zone 3 or 4. I may have this. No, that's up here, the Murmansk area, and without taking Norway, I'm not going to get that. Axis port in C zone 6. That's going to be way up there, right at Murmansk. Yeah, good luck getting that. And then C-Zone 32 versus Soviets and West. And that's going to be over here for the pipeline going up through Iraq. Okay, so I'm not going to get any bonuses. It's kind of neat to see these. I probably should have looked before. C-Zone 13 and no Western fighters or warships in C-Zone 13. It's over here. That sure doesn't apply. And for every 3 allied countries conquered by the Axis, there's going to be more of an effort to help the Soviets. Well, I've conquered Poland, and that's it. So no bonuses there. So it looks like I get a die for each. Am I going to get a modifier? There are event markers that can help. Okay. In particular, I'm going to worry about the submarines, the surface, And yeah, I don't think the surface is going to do anything in this. I think those just act as fleets. But let's make sure. Yeah. Okay, so let's see if I can use submarines against the Russians. Would make some sense. Either way. I could accept it either way. I can play one against the Soviet faction. So what that's going to do is that's going to have the Soviet die roll. And I want to use it for that. Now, you might say, well, are you sure? Because this is going to have a die roll as to when it can come back into play. But, you know, even though I have this every turn, I want to do as much damage as I can as early as I can, because that helps, actually. So that's going to take me 6 turns to recuperate. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That doesn't mean there's no submarine combat for the rest of it. It's just going to be factored in on the tracks, and you'll see how that works. Okay. So, there's no die roll for that, is there? Yeah, it's just going to divide the Soviet faction in half. So, to me, it looks like we have no modifiers whatsoever. Except for the Soviets are going to be divided in half. So, the Soviets get a 2, the Germans get a 3. That's a boink. So the factory loss markers go back 1. Now, they're both at the minimum 1. So I'm not going to worry about that. I don't think I factored them into my points here. Let me make sure I got my counts right. So my factory count is 9, 8, doubled. 8, 9. Doubled should have been 18 and I spent 1. And likewise for the Germans, I think I'm back 2 points as well. I'm at 14 factories, 13. That puts me to 26 instead of 28. And I spent 1 to help the Hungarians. Great. And that's not going to modify anything. I thought there was a modifier for how many hits you have. But it doesn't look like there is. There's a modifier for bombed factories. But I thought there was actually a modifier for how badly you were doing in the strategic warfare. And I guess I'm mistaken about that. All right, well, it's on to the German action phase, and we'll see what they can do in poor weather. The Germans got pretty lucky here, actually. I don't know if I moved a little bit here in Romania. I don't think so. But took Lithuania out, popped a couple of Russian units in there, and then also launched massive set of attacks in here after canceling out the Soviet air power that was there. These guys still exist and are still powerful. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, but they were just outside of the range to be able to actually be helpful. That means the Soviets actually have a lot of air power comparatively, though. I've got this knocked out. This is down to -5, and for whatever it matters, this one's knocked out. I was kind of careful not to actually move into this hex, because that'll allow a free move for the Soviets to get that plane out of there. Otherwise, they're going to have to either use a strategic move to get it out, which has now become impossible. Eventually, I'm going to have to take that hex and drive it away. But as it stands right now, they can't reposition them because it's at the 6 points. Anyway, Lithuania fell. Pieces are here. Additional units in the eliminated box for that. An additional pip in here. And I forgot about something. I don't have to take Latvia. Instead, what I was able to do was remove the pro-Soviet leaning in Turkey, which I viewed as far more valuable. Latvia, I may want to take in the long run. So that's kind of a positive move there. I would have liked to have been able to take Romania. Maybe if I had shifted this plane down here instead of here, I would have had it in range, and I would have been able to, you know, push a Hungarian, not quite like that, but like this, and do an assault. Let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Yeah, I would have been able to do that. An assault with these two units with support. Maybe I could have done it. Maybe. Not sure if I could throw paratroopers. Yeah, I could throw paratroopers in there too, because they'd be in range of the plane. So, you know, I'd have another plus 2 from that. This is, however, in the severe weather zone. Probably unlikely that I'd actually take this. Maybe impossible that I'd take the city. So I'm pretty happy with what I got. I got my German spending at exactly the point I want it, where I can rebuild everything. Well, rebuild all my units as much as possible. Build the new garrison that I want, which I could actually put on the west front and then push some Germans forward if need be, through strategic movement. The Italians did good jobs up here supporting German units in the attack. That worked very, very well. And, you know, I mean, I'm not gaining tons of ground here. There's no question. There's enough Russians to prevent me from just charging forward very rapidly. But remember, these turns were only a month each, so you're going to see a slower progression than you do in, say, Third Reich. Things that are on my mind just at this point in the game. One is, you know, when I played the original, the print and play, Case Blue version of this, I remember being kind of positive about it, and then as time passed, kind of thinking, there was a little bit too much thought, a little bit too much analysis paralysis for my taste. And then as I was playing more with this, I'm beginning to realize, you know, I'm still having a lot of fun in a sense that maybe I wasn't with Axis Empires to the same degree. I felt kind of frustrated with not being able to, not really knowing the situation as well. I don't feel that here. I feel like it's not that big a deal to shoot from the hip. I still do get caught in an analysis paralysis trap because there's this capability to kind of plan out your entire move and figure out, all right, you know, if I launch this attack here, then I'm going to need these planes for that. So there's a lot of interleaving of the different pieces and trying to think of what you want to do. But even within that, it does feel a little lighter, more on the lines of a Third Reich type of game in terms of there may be more that's under your control, but there's less pieces. So I think it kind of balances out nicely, and what it doesn't do is it doesn't leave me with this, oh, what the hell do I do? It feels pretty likely. Yeah, the mechanisms to learn for this, I don't think have the same kind of learning curve that they do in Axis Empires, or in the naval rules for WIF. But there's still a lot of room for that heavy thinking. You know, the attack took a few minutes to figure out, and I kind of get to that, oh geez, what am I going to do in terms of how am I going to do, even if I know everything that I need to know fairly easily. I don't find myself having to look up too many things in the rules, though. I've got my chits here. They tell me, hey, these are the options that I have. What can I do with these? And yeah, I could have used these Italian tanks. That was kind of stupid not to do. They would have added one to the modifiers, but I got lucky enough anyway. I did use the Soviet tanks and the Soviet support to try to prevent things from getting too bad, but yeah, you know, I took a lot of morale hits on the Soviets here. Their will is down to 33 at this point. And I'm not even losing cities. Right, I don't think I've lost a single Russian. Yeah, I'm still in Poland here. I haven't lost a single Russian city yet. And once those start falling, that's when it's gonna maybe decrease a little bit more rapidly. We've really got to worry. I think the Russians are gonna collapse within this year. And that, you know, that's the goal, right? You know, knock out France quickly, or can you hit Russia before the Western allies come into play? Of course, then Russia gets a timer reset, and they're going to come back in. They're not done. You make that Moscow treaty, you still got to come back and face them again. But I'm hoping to buy enough time with that. Now, the French, unfortunately, have a lot more pieces somewhere. I don't remember what happened. Oh, yeah, those pieces are the those guys from the Mediterranean crisis. So I'm not too worried about France pounding into me. What I'm worried about is that I won't be as capable of taking out the Western line as I was, you know, or as I would be, say, in early 1940. There are some Allied units in here that's going to make that denser and harder to cope with. I screwed up with the Russians by marching into here. I don't know if it's totally a screw-up. I kind of want it because it's nice terrain there. It helps protect Vilnius, which is more nice terrain. But the problem is, this creates a line of supply for this poor plane here. If I have the points, I'm going to upgrade that plane, but I don't know that I will have those points. Largely, I made an attack against the Hungarians here, too. Just drove them back. They used, but I did make them use up a ground support chit, which is way out here now, so there's some advantage to that. Overall, I don't have much I'm filling in. The big problem I have is this hole right here. However, I can do a strategic move into place there, so I should be okay. I'm moving these Russians down. I should have plenty of supply points. We'll see if it's enough. But I guess I'm done with the Russians. I'm happy enough with the position I'm in, I suppose. I'm going to suffer more losses, there's no question. I'm just hoping something can help me out. The Western Allies, when they come in, they'll boost my morale. So at least there's that, but that's that's still a year away, right? Alright. So I guess we go to the replacement and the economic stuff there. Okay, so that's the end of the April turn, and for production, the Soviets were not able to afford this and still do the diplomacy they wanted to. The Germans got a diplomatic success. They placed it in Yugoslavia. Then after the Western Allies reloaded the cup for them, the Soviets got one and removed it from Yugoslavia. The way the game works, being on the defensive, it doesn't really help you having a lot of minor allies. You want them when you're on the offensive. Because, you know, say I got Turkey in the game. Well, what is that going to do? I can declare war on Bulgaria, but I won't be able to intervene in Romania as long as Romania is still a Soviet allied country. So it seems more important to prevent additional forces and economic production from being shifted to the east. I was a little worried about the idea of tons and tons of Italians being in the East Front, but to tell you the truth, I'm not all that enthused about throwing more Italians into the front. They're helpful, there's no question about that, and maybe I can, you know, find room to shift another unit up into the East Front still, because when I do an assault, they add to that value. But I don't want to rely on minor allies to try to win territories for me. So because they just don't have the quality that the German troops do. They're the equivalent to those Russian infantry. And you can see a lot more Russian infantry on the board. This is still my hole, but I've got forces up on the line, actually in Kiev now. And that just seemed more important than trying to get this airplane up to back down to 4 sorties so that I could pull it out on its own. Airplanes are great, but I can't really afford the cost of what really was 3 units, or the political cost of running my production at full tilt and just ignoring the Yugoslav success that the Germans were likely going to get, I think. All right.